The European Space Agency, or ESA, commissioned a visionary moon village design from Skidmore, Owings and Merrill, or SOM, a collective of architects, designers, engineers and planners. With decades of expertise in crafting buildings and urban spaces, SOM's team blends technical prowess with innovative design to plan a permanent lunar settlement. In this video, we'll explore SOM's design, assess its practicality, and explore the technical details and trade-offs involved. We'll also compare it with NASA's Artemis Base Camp plan to highlight their similarities and differences. Charged with planning a lasting return to the Moon, SOM's Moon Village is conceived as a multinational outpost. It aims to foster scientific research, support commercial ventures such as lunar resource extraction and processing, and potentially pave the way for tourism. Inspired by the International Space Station, the design emphasizes global collaboration, resilience, and self-sufficiency to create a sustainable lunar presence. The Moon Village design balances engineering constraints with a deep understanding of how humans interact with their living spaces, creating an environment suited for long-term habitation. It also maximizes the use of local lunar resources. Despite the name, it's not an actual village, more of a lunar outpost on the Moon. We'll continue using the Moon Village name throughout the video for consistency. Self-sufficient living beyond Earth. SOM's Moon Village master plan selects the rim of Shackleton Crater, the Moon's prime real estate, as its ideal location. Nestled on the Shackleton-Durgalash connective ridge near the South Pole, this site links Shackleton and Durgalash craters. Known as part of the Peaks of Eternal Light, the ridge enjoys near continuous sunlight up to 90% of the lunar year, making it perfect for solar power generation. This strategic location offers proximity to permanently shadowed craters, rich in water ice and frozen volatiles. These resources can be extracted to produce drinking water, breathable air, and rocket propellant, supporting life, transportation, and industrial activities. They also hold potential for commercial use, improving the outpost's economic viability. Beyond resource harvesting, the site advances the Moon Village's core mission of unique scientific research. The nearby shadowed craters preserve untouched materials from the solar system's early history, offering invaluable insights into its formation. Phased development of the Moon Village. The Moon Village will be constructed in carefully planned stages to ensure a sustainable and scalable lunar outpost. Phase 1, initial habitat. The first stage establishes a single habitat module designed to house a crew of four. This crew will live, work, and lay the groundwork for expanding the settlement, focusing on early construction and site preparation. Phase 2, infrastructure expansion. Additional infrastructure will gradually arrive to support critical operations, including excavation, manufacturing, and construction. Timing is key. Excavation equipment, for example, requires robust power systems, such as solar arrays, microgrids, and battery or fuel cell storage to be installed first. Phase 3, specialized modules. As the outpost grows, new habitation units will be added, serving as hubs for food production, scientific laboratories, and other specialized functions to improve self-sufficiency and research capabilities. Phase 4, thriving lunar community. In its final vision, the Moon Village evolves into a vibrant community, bustling with scientists, engineers, explorers, construction workers, and even tourists, ensuring a dynamic lunar presence. Designing the modular habitat. The habitation module is a hybrid rigid-soft structural system. It consists of a rigid frame and an inflatable structural shell for environmental protection. Habitat structure and layout. The module spans four levels, accommodating a crew of four with dedicated spaces for crew quarters, laboratories, and robotic control stations. Initially designed for a 500-day mission, the duration was reduced to 300 days due to radiation concerns. To improve safety, crew quarters were relocated from the top floor to a lower level, doubling as a storm shelter during solar flares. Future plans include using locally sourced lunar water as an additional radiation barrier once in-situ resource utilization is operational. The net habitable volume is 388 cubic meters and is optimized for human comfort and functionality. The mass of the habitat is 48 tons, with a height of 15.5 meters, that's 50 feet, and a diameter, once deployed, of 10.5 meters, or 34 feet. Multiple modules will form clusters linked by communication towers positioned at the highest point of the ridge. The habitat design has a high ceiling to floor space because the moon has much lower gravity, only 1/6 of Earth's gravity, so crew can reach up much higher with grab bars installed for mobility support. The habitat requires approximately 60 kilowatts of power, informed by the International Space Station's experience. Abundant solar energy from the South Pole's near-continuous sunlight will meet this demand, with ESA also exploring a surface-deployed fission reactor as a future option. Radiators will dissipate waste heat to maintain a comfortable internal temperature of 22 degrees Celsius. Life support systems, drawing on ESA's expertise, will include local food production to supplement Earth-supplied provisions. One big challenge is the mass of the habitat, including all the pre-installed equipment. The total mass is expected to be 58 tons, which is beyond the scope of lunar landers, with a single exception of SpaceX's Starship vehicle. After the first habitat module is deployed, additional modules customized for different tasks, such as research, manufacturing, food production, and tourism, would be added and connected. Crew living stations. Each crew member has a private quarter for sleeping, personal office, private conference, and personal recreation. Astronauts will spend a large part of their time in these quarters, so they must be well protected from ionizing radiation. In addition, a galley and food station are included in the habitat design. For long-duration habitation, these areas will include an oven or microwave, freezers, sink and dishwasher, and storage space for cooking utensils and food supplies. A dedicated waste and hygiene section supports personal care, including body cleansing, oral hygiene and grooming. The toilet, enclosed by an airtight door, is complemented by storage racks for hygiene supplies, maintaining cleanliness and privacy. To maintain physical health in the moon's low gravity, the habitat includes fitness equipment, such as a treadmill and resistance bands. Basic medical supplies and equipment are also provided to address minor health needs, ensuring crew well-being during extended stays. For safe access to the lunar surface, two airlocks, designed as separate units rather than integrated into the habitat, provide redundancy, enhancing safety and operational flexibility. Power requirements. Various studies have estimated a wide range of values for the electrical power requirements of a human lunar habitat, anywhere from 10 to 60 kilowatts of continuous power for a fully crewed habitat. For a real-world benchmark, the International Space Station, which supports 6 crew members and has a similar pressurized volume, provides a useful reference. The ISS delivers 84 kilowatts of continuous power, with a peak capacity of 108 kilowatts. According to ESA's study on the Moon Village design, and the link is in the description, the habitat requires approximately 57 kilowatts during the lunar day and 60 kilowatts during the lunar night to sustain operations and crew needs. Solar power plant and backup systems. To meet the Moon Village's power needs, solar arrays must be carefully positioned to avoid mutual shadowing. These vertical arrays, designed to track the sun's position, are optimized for the South Pole's low-angle sunlight. However, even with ideal placement, up to 5 days of darkness may occur, requiring a robust backup power system for continuous habitation. Backup power options. ESA's analysis for a habitat requiring 59 kilowatts of continuous power evaluates two backup systems. Battery backup. This system, with a mass of 68 tons, is significantly heavier and less practical. Fuel cell backup. At 14 tons, this option is lighter and more feasible. Nuclear fission alternative. A nuclear fission system, based on a NASA technology program, offers a compelling alternative. A 40 kilowatt reactor serves as a reference, but scaling to meet the habitat's 59 kilowatt requirement would result in a system weighing approximately 5 tons. Nuclear fission is the lightest and most compact option, providing consistent power regardless of location, which improves mission flexibility. Given its advantages in mass, compactness, and reliability, ESA selects nuclear fission as the baseline power solution for the Moon Village. comparison with NASA's Artemis Base Camp. The Moon Village and NASA's Artemis Base Camp share a vision for sustainable lunar outposts near the Moon's South Pole, with similar objectives but different approaches. Let's look at some of the shared goals. Long-term lunar presence. Both aim to establish a lasting presence on the Moon, supporting recurring missions rather than continuous habitation. Scientific research. Each includes scientific labs and equipment to advance lunar and planetary science. In situ resource utilization. Both prioritize living off the land by prospecting, harvesting, and processing lunar resources, such as water ice for life support and rocket fuel. Mars preparation. The outposts serve as testing grounds for technologies critical for Mars missions, including radiation protection, life support systems, and surface mobility. Location. Both target the South Pole, with the Shackleton de Galache Connective Ridge a strong candidate for Artemis Base Camp, aligning with the Moon Village's chosen site. Here are some key differences between these plans. Scale and scope. Artemis Base Camp is designed for small crews of 4 to 6 astronauts on missions lasting weeks to months, requiring minimal infrastructure. In contrast, the Moon Village proposes a larger, multinational settlement supporting science, commercial activities, and tourism. Habitat design. NASA opts for rugged, proven habitat designs optimized for shorter missions, while the Moon Village employs a hybrid, rigid soft shell system optimized for long duration missions. Site selection. While the Moon Village is set on the Shackleton de Galache Connective Ridge, NASA has yet to finalize Artemis Base Camp's exact location, though the same ridge is under consideration. Final thoughts. The Moon Village design is a research-driven initiative without a fixed timeline or funding commitment. It aligns with ESA's long-term goals and supports NASA's Artemis program of a return to the Moon in a more sustainable way than Apollo. The design uses near-term technologies, but engineering and funding challenges remain. Without more funding from the national governments that comprise ESA, this initiative is unlikely to be realized. NASA, with more funding and non-partisan support, is more likely to have sufficient funding to continue with their lunar plans. What are your thoughts on the Moon Village design? Do you believe the Artemis Base Camp's focus on smaller, shorter missions is more practical? Share your views in the comment below. Okay, that's a wrap. Thanks for watching. Space News Live is on Saturday evening or Sunday morning, depending where you watch from. I recap the videos I posted this week, answer questions, respond to comments and chat messages, cover any missed news, and preview upcoming content. I'd love for you to join if you can. Be sure to like and subscribe so you'll see our upcoming videos. We make videos every week covering the space industry, with an emphasis on the smaller space startups that aren't covered so well on other channels. See you soon.